listen to the sound of footsteps in the dark, to voices that may not be quite human, to the sound of screams in the night, to the haunted cabaret, the home of all things horror, on RhodeIslandFreeRadio.org, with your host, George Garner. The Haunted Cabaret starts now.
Guns N' Roses, Mr. Brownstone. This is the Haunted Cabaret on Rhode Island Free Radio. I'm your host, George Garner. And I'll tell you, I didn't think it was possible anymore for a musical announcement to cause me to basically, metaphorically, come in my pants. But it has happened. And the cause of it is Metal Blade Records 35th Anniversary Tour. This will take place at the Brighton Music Hall, Boston, Massachusetts, Wednesday, February 22nd in the year 2017, starting at 6 p.m. The lineup is as follows: Elysian, Whitechapel, Cattle Decapitation, and Goat Whore. Now, as anyone who has listened to this show more than once knows, Goat Whore is my favorite band in this universe. followed closely by what I like to call the Unholy Metal 3 of Whitechapel and Cattle Decapitation. I don't know if there's any kind of like psychic connection that I've made with the promoters of this event. I don't know. Or maybe it's just, you know, Satan taking care of his own. I'm being rewarded pre-hell for my loyalty to this program, which, Tony, how many programs have we reeled out of this sucker so
tonight
far?
Tonight is episode 56.
There you go. I'm being prematurely rewarded by the powers of darkness. But yes, Whitechapel, Cattle Decap. I haven't heard Allegian, so I'll have to give that a listen when I get there. But Whitechapel, Cattle Decapitation, and Goat Whore. I mean, an hour of each. I mean, how can that be better?
And it's a fairly intimate venue for a tour package that size.
Yeah, you said about, you know, well, we're from Roundabouts, Lovecraft, Providence, so the comparison you made was Lupo's Heartbreak Hotel,
yeah.
Right? Yeah, a very intimate. You can smell the goat, and you can smell the whore. And I intend to be up close smelling both. Especially, well, I'm going to have to smell the whores that are there, though, because as Tony Jones pointed out, you know, the first thing that came to my mind was, okay, who do I bring to the show with me? And Tony very astutely pointed out that the new wife is in no way interested in this show. So needless to say, you know, I started thinking, okay, well, who else would want to? And, you know, my mind started doing some lively imagining until, I don't know what it was, but if anyone's ever seen The Lord of the Rings, how that ring of Sauron glows on your finger when you're thinking either unpleasant thoughts or... this wedding ring on my finger, I felt sudden pain from where the finger meets the palm of the hand. And yeah, so I think, yeah, so that basically got me off the subject of thinking who else I was going to go with, you know, and much more properly who I might meet when I get there. But I'm not responsible for that. This is the age of social media.
Right.
Yeah, I am not responsible for that. But the other thing is that I really couldn't, you know, betray the wife when she's home as we speak. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a washer and a dryer in our house for the first time. It was hooked up by the electrician today. As we speak, clothes are being washed that I haven't washed in, I'm thinking maybe we'd like, because... One good thing about this girl I married is she's as like cheap as I am when it comes to non-necessary things.
Oh, see, it's not necessarily the cheapness for me with laundry. I just hate doing it.
You think
I hate being there. It's like, it's almost as depressing as the DMV.
Well, I know she hates doing the laundry. Yeah, both of us do. But we thought that we might enjoy it more if we had like nice, shiny new appliances.
Yeah, and you can do it in your own home, not around a bunch of freaks.
Right. You know, go to the laundromat and... The reward for standing around these freaks waiting for the laundry to finish at 2 o'clock in the morning is that you pay. I think last time we did it a couple of months ago, we paid like $13 all told between like shoving it all in the washing machine, watching it, you know, wash, you know, then putting it in the dryer. I'll tell you, it was up there. It was like $10, $13. I mean, it's a few quarters at a time, but that's ridiculous. It adds up. And plus, the place stank a little bit. Like, you know, there's odors unique to a laundromat, kind of like there's odors unique to a metal club.
Strip club.
Yeah, there are. What do you, not a strip club, but a peep show, as Tony Jones used to like to attend back in the old days before they became obsolete, thanks to the strip clubs now offering the peep shows and the other services. Right now,
damn you, Rudy Giuliani. You ruined Times Square.
Well, he ruined it in the sense of, you know, nostalgia for the old timers. But, you know, for people our age, I think things are much improved. It's, you know, the sex industry is consolidated, right? Because before, and actually I think we got to reward the United States government for this too, because before the days of George Bush and Barack Obama, strippers used to make enough money just stripping.
Yeah.
So that they didn't have to, as they say, finish.
They didn't have to partake in extracurricular activities.
Right. They could just take all that money they made stripping and use it to pay for their college educations. Now they usually have to swallow after stripping, you know, in order to pay for even CCRI.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, things are not good out there for the strippers. And when things are not good out there for the sex industry, you know that the American economy is suffering. So we'll see what Mr. Trump has to do about that. I'm sure he'll be a big supporter of the consolidated sex industry, though.
Well, back to Rudy Giuliani, you know, responsible for cleaning up Times Square, getting rid of the peep shows while having a bunch of mistresses on the side.
Well, he didn't quite clean it up completely, because you'll remember that last time we played in New York over on East 14th Street, I think it was, at Trash Bar, I did Tony Jones the service of scouting out the city. I found the last remaining peep show. It's not my fault that you didn't take me up on it and go to it. I mean, I found it. There was one left. Next time we go, I'll encourage you to go there again.
I just hope it doesn't have the original actresses that you're peeping in on.
You know, the original jizz mop. I don't know. Is there an actual person that cleans up those places, or do they just let the stuff rot on the floor until it, you know, just kind of biodegrades?
I don't know. There's got to be some kind of a health code, right?
I guess. Well, I know in Providence there wouldn't be any health code, because there'd just be a $5,000 payoff, you know, to make the health code go away. Yep. Yeah. But I don't know. I guess New York has taken a swing back toward the liberal. So, yeah, they probably are sucking money out of the – yeah, there's probably a health code there in force somewhere.
You know, funny story, a friend of mine, he worked at a pizza parlor. Things were slow, so his job was to take flyers and pass them out, you know, about the pizza joint.
Right.
Well, he said, forget about this. Instead of passing out flyers, I'm going to go over to the Amazing Superstore and use the masturbation booth. So he throws the flyers in the dumpster, goes over to the booth, puts his money in. He sits down, and the guy that was in there before him relieved himself onto the plastic patio furniture that is in there, and he said he just slid right out of the chair onto the ground. So nobody was mopping that one, at least.
So in other words, he didn't notice the defecation because of what, the dim lighting, or he was just is it the friend? I think it might have been, who was just too shit-faced to notice.
No, well, this guy was he was on the clock, so he was sober, but he just slid right out of it.
Okay, so this wasn't the old our old buddy Link Poison.
No.
Because that's the name that first came to mind for some reason as going into a superstore peep show.
Well, especially at the tail end of his marriage, where he told us, you know, he hadn't been intimate with his wife in a good dozen years.
Well, that's because he had been drinking heavily for a good dozen years, and he wasn't able to get into his wife if he propped that thing up with a stick. Oh, just to give credit where it's due, though, this character that we're talking about is, I guess you would say, the root of the Tony Jones and the Cretan Three musical tree.
True, yeah.
It's true because, this questionable character used to be called Russ Robillard, nephew of the great Duke Robillard, and the whole saga of Providence Rock would have been different if he didn't put an ad into the paper looking for musicians to fuel his midlife crisis. Well, no, he didn't put it that way. He just said that he was looking for musicians to start a band. But I was bored, so I called. And from that, you know, then we got a couple of other people who have since fallen by the wayside. We went from Russ Robillard to the Gorners, a couple of incarnations of the Gorners, several incarnations of Tony Jones and the Cretan Three, and here we are still today.
And the best part of that is that Link really is into playing music at one point. So he sells his business,
yep,
and he wants to play music full time. So he brokers this deal, sells his business, sells his truck. Yep, yeah, it was a landscaping business. Sold the business, sold the truck, moves into where we practiced so he could become a full-time musician, and then quit the band 2 weeks later.
Yeah, because he didn't want to be a slave to a schedule of gigs, apparently. That's all I got out of him. Yeah. As a matter of fact, I think he quit right in the middle of Tony Jones wasn't around at the time. I think it was a couple of other disreputables that I don't bear thinking about. But, yeah, we were in the studio recording our first CD as the Providence Gorners. And, Link, he took a powder right
he's
in the middle.
He's gone, right?
Huh?
He's just gone.
Just gone. He said, it's your band now. And the next thing we heard from him, actually, we didn't hear from him for years, right? The next thing we heard from him was a phone call we got here at the studio. Hey, Hey, Tony Jones and the Korean Three, I saw you guys a couple of times on the TV. I guess you guys are doing really good now. Then pause. Now, you know either the request for money's coming or the request to join the band is coming. You know that. You know it's going to happen. Oh, well, you know, I was thinking of starting this band, but I don't know. What kind of band was he thinking of starting in his numb state?
Some kind of alternative country punk fusion.
Alternative country punk fusion. I think yeah, the only thing he left out was folk at the end there, or singer-songwriter. But, yeah, no, yeah, alternative country punk rock thing. Yeah. And naturally, we just said, okay, we'll think about it. We'll get back to you. And we basically did the same thing you do when you get a piece of junk mail in the, in the snail mail and you file it. We filed him. Listen, bad habit's one thing. You want to go on a bender? That's another thing. You don't walk out of a recording studio in the middle of a CD recording. You just don't. You want to do 8 songs, you do 4 of them and leave. Anyway, getting back to the music. Now, this is a band that never quit. I mean, I think you can truly say these guys were pioneers of metal.
Right to the grave.
Yeah, pioneers of speed metal. Right to the grave. The day before he died, that man was still making music. This is Motorhead, Killed by Death, and that's the only thing that could stop him. On the Haunted Cabaret here in Rhode Island, Free Radio.
We'll be right back.
All right, that was Motorhead, Killed by Death. And you just have to wonder how many Forster Lagers Lemmy drank that night to come up with the simplistic genius of those lyrics. I don't know. But I'll tell you, that imitation I just did of Lincoln Douglas Poison, I don't know, Tony, do you think my imitative skills, do you think that's an underutilized gift I have? Should I try that a little bit more on the air?
Yeah, you know, you should, but in a case like Lincoln, nobody knows who you're talking about. So, I mean,
well, I know. We do now. That's why I had to go on that. By the way, that wasn't just all a setup for a segue into Killed by Death. That was by way of explaining who this person was that I was imitating. Yeah, you don't want to. You're right, though. You don't. As a general rule, you don't want to imitate unknown people.
Right, yeah.
Of course, nobody's going to fault you for getting it wrong if you imitate an unknown person. Especially if you imitate, like, a person who's, I guess, an archetype of, you know, the quintessential drunk under the crawl space. We all know one. So, yeah. So, you know, our listeners might not all know who Lincoln Poison was, but we all know the type.
And these people do exist.
Oh, temporarily they exist. You know, until they're eaten by roaches or rats or whatever else might be sharing. Oh, I saw this great story, and it came even through Facebook. Which I was really surprised because I've given up on Facebook as far as anything entertaining anymore, because everybody does it. I mean, I think Facebook is the fulfillment of the rule that as soon as everybody's doing it, as soon as the soccer moms are doing it, stop doing it.
Kiss of death.
I'm thinking about just getting this thing off my smartphone. I'm thinking, get rid of it. I'm thinking, if I was to get rid of Facebook, though, what social media would I go to that's a little bit more, a little bit more something? Like, not as lame.
Twitter moves really quickly, but it's some pretty decent content.
Yeah, but Donald Trump has invalidated Twitter. How about, there's some of these other ones I've heard just the names of and haven't tried them out. Like, a lot of them are just for tweens, right? Like, Vine and Instagram and things like that. I don't know. Maybe I'll just forego social media altogether and just... I will never forego texting, though. I love texting. I guess, you know, what Twitter is to Donald Trump and the BlackBerry was to Barack Obama, you know, texting is to me. I mean... It's a wonderful thing. You can get the necessary information back and forth without having to speak to the person that you're in. You know, it just eliminates so much wasted, hey, how you doings? It really does.
And it optimizes the time that you can be productive while on the toilet.
It does.
I mean, you know, you don't want to make a business call on the job. You know, hey, man, how's it going?
Yeah, and there's always that... other people have told me that they're really offended by, because I do this, because I like to put things in their proper setting. So when I'm calling, let's say a bank, or I'm calling a car dealer, or I'm calling any kind of disreputable corporation like that, I like to do it sitting on the toilet taking a dump. I mean, I just feel it's the proper setting for a call to those scumbags of whatever, you know, phase of American economy. So, yeah. But... where was I going with this? This is something about the appropriateness, I think. You ever have one of those situations where your brain just... Well, I know Tony has.
All day, every day.
All day, every day. Well, anyway, returning to the point, basically, I'm just sick of social media. I think... I don't know. I mean, would that be cool to just dump it all and ahead of... a proverbial curve, or would I be seen? Actually, I don't care how I'm seen. It's just I would be rid of this major annoyance. It's a major annoyance because now all the assholes that you've spent your time avoiding, this is how I look at it anyway. But anybody, you know, fans of this thing, feel free. You know, Mark Zuckerberg, if you want to defend yourself on my little program, feel free. Why you created this god-awful piece of Facebook crap and brought it into existence. Well, I know you did it to make yourself $1 billion.
That helps.
I can respect that. I know you did it to compile more information about every American, well, not just American, but right, every citizen on the face of this planet that you could later sell to a hostile government for trillions of dollars. I can respect that. But do I really have to? Yeah, when I think of the people that I've spent time avoiding, that, and guess which ones, when you sit down there to take a dump and you go on Facebook, who shows up first? The people that you have prided yourself on avoiding for the last 10 years, because 10 years ago was enough to want to speak to these people face to face. They had nothing to say then. They have nothing to say now.
They have less to say now.
They have less to say now. Now
they've been on the couch for the last decade.
Yeah, getting bloated and and getting bad skin. Like, especially all the women that I, you know, said no to back then. They're all, you know, they're puffy, they're bloated, they're alcoholic, and I'm just glad that I said no. And I'm even gladder for the ones that said no to me. That is the most satisfying. I'll tell you. And the ones that said no to me, not that many.
Now they're gross.
Yeah. I mean, put it this way. They look like Donald Trump's dog kennel. That's, you know, if you go to like the Slater Park Animal Shelter, I mean, you know, I'm sure you'll find a couple of my ex-love interests in that animal shelter picked up by mistake because they grew too much facial hair, because they burned their brains out on whatever chemical substance I thought was cute at the time. You know, once a chemical substance or alcoholic beverage stops helping you get laid, then it's just gross.
Yeah.
Really. I mean, and if you make the mistake of hooking up with one of those people, well, that's what divorce is for. I mean, it's the divorce is a blessing sent by Satan. But I don't know, if it wasn't for no-fault divorce, I think they should outlaw probably beer and hallucinogens. Especially, Tony, you ever notice, like, when you see a it'll be a trilogy, right? Three people moving down the street together. One is a baby. One is a female that looks like she came from the Coney Island sideshow, you know, out into the sunlight when she shouldn't ought to do it. And the other one is a guy who looks basically like, well, basically like one of those guys that stands in front of the judge for a mass murder and just and he just finds out he's death sentenced. And they just, you know, they don't have any more electricity, so they're going to kill you with a low dose of, Vladimir Putin radioactive isotope or something like that, and it's going to be really painful. Yeah. That's how you can tell the guys that drank too much and proposed or drank too much and got her pregnant, because they always have this expression on their face.
And he's holding her purse.
Yeah, he's pushing the carriage. He's holding her purse. But you know the purse is empty. You know, all the important stuff is in her pocket. So, yeah, enough said about that. So, I don't know. So, I think I'm in the mood these days to do away with social media in my life. Well, now that I'm married, I mean, you know, chemical additives to make other women look better. I mean, beer is a girl's best friend. I mean, let's face it. I don't know. I think, is this because we're approaching the new year and I'm being caught up in that standard New Year's restitution? No, New Year's revolution. No, New Year's restitution. New Year's
resolution?
Yeah, those. Yeah, I had forgotten the word because I never make them. Although every now and then if somebody pushes me and says, oh, what's your New Year's? You know, like one of these idiots that I don't want to see anymore and they show up on Facebook. This is the perfect person and the perfect question to show up on my friggin' Facebook and just ruin my day. You know, some jerk. Let me think. Yeah, it would have to be probably, like, I can think of a few of them. I can name first names. I just can't name last names for fear of libel. But, yeah, I mean, I've been trying to avoid, say, Nancy for about 10 years. And she comes back into my life on Facebook asking, so what's your New Year's What's your New Year's
resolution?
Resolution. I've only made one, and this one I think I told Tony a while back. My only resolution that I've ever made in my life for New Year's is I intend to gain weight. Now, let's think about this. Why would somebody want to make a New Year's resolution that you're automatically going to fail to live up to, right? If I make a resolution to gain weight a year from now, if I've gained it, I'm successful and I can be proud. I'm one of the few people on this earth that kept their New Year's resolution. If I don't gain any, then that's good too, because I failed, but I'm a better person for having failed. You know, because now I can keep up with the younger woman that I married. And that, I mean, you guys knew that, right? You knew I married a younger, I would have to marry a younger woman. You know, I can't marry a woman my age. They're all dried up. Like, they really do. I mean, like, what are they, you know, I mean, a woman over, what, 40? It's like, what do they come with? It? You know, they show up at the altar in the bridal dress with a I don't know, a tube of what, lubricant?
Cocoa butter?
Something. Yeah. I, you know, do you take this woman and her tube of cocoa butter? It's like, I just can't. I just can't. Well, sometimes being a trendsetter, as we are here, and the Haunted Cabaret and Tony Jones and the Cretan Three, sometimes being cool, sometimes being a trendsetter, carries its burdens. And that's one of them. Being unable to hook up with a woman over 40 who's carrying a tube of lubricant. We just can't do it here, Tony. I will never let you do it either. In the meantime, what we can do is we can do double shots.
Speaking of bands that get you laid.
Yeah, really, big time. Yeah, we're going to do a double shot. Not a double shot of the shitty bands that play on HJY. We're going to do a double shot of one of our favorite bands and the creators of one of the most legendary. And it's gotten, you know, good notice, but we think it's one of the best CDs ever created, one of the best albums ever recorded. This is Smithereens. We're going to do a two-shot. Hand of Glory and Behind the Wall of Sleep, and we'll see you in 6 minutes.
Now I lie in bed and think of her. Sometimes I even bass guitar, and she was playing in a band, and she stood just like the woman. Now I am her biggest fan. Now I know I'm one of many who would like to be your friend, and I've got to find a way to let you know I'm not like them. Now I'm lying in bed and think of her. Sometimes I even weep. Then I dream of her behind the wall and sleep.
That was a twofer from the Smithereens, Hand of Glory and Behind the Wall of Sleep here on the Haunted Cabaret. And Behind the Wall of Sleep, I can identify, and you know, let's admit it, all of us can probably identify. We've all met a female bass player, you know, sometime in our lives that, you know, we were smitten with, and or at least until, you know, she quit the band and, you know, had kids or, you know, something else happened to her. The female bass player in my life was named Lisa, and I'll leave out the last name so she doesn't find me, you know, and probably put a bullet in me for what I'll probably say next. But
she's still playing music?
Last I heard, she was. Although I think it's the kind of music that you play in cover bars in third-rate country western bands.
So she's getting paid at least.
A little bit. I think, yeah, she's basically eking out a living, you know, playing bass for bloated, middle-aged, failed male country western singers. You know, and I'm sure, you know, there's, as a matter of fact, I think she married one of them. So she started out in the alternative music scene, progressed through the gay-lesbian scene in Providence.
Wow.
And, yeah. She was cool for a while. I don't. Can you? Is it kind of like the born again Christians talk about religion? You know what I'm saying? You're in God's grace, but you can lose it if you screw up too much. I mean, because for a while there, she was cool. I mean, I had a real reason for it. As a matter of fact, I quit drinking hard liquor so I could remember what I did with her that night. True story. I mean, because I guess after a while, your body starts to reject, you know, certain things after you've abused it too long. So I remember. One night, when I went to see her band, back when it was a real band that you wanted to go see, you know, I got there, and while she was playing her set, you know, I drank, I think it was like 3 Seagram 7 and Cokes. And they finished their set. She jumped off the stage. She saw me across the room. She says, "Hey, George," and, you know, starts hurrying toward me with her arms mm-hmm. out. And then I woke up in my friend's basement later that night. So, and I asked him, I says, "What happened?" And, you know, he says, "Oh, nothing bad." So anyway, so that, yeah, so for I've gotten back on it now because, like I said, I'm not interested anymore. But, yeah, I quit drinking hot alcohol for, I don't know, at least 4 or 5 years after that because I didn't want to black out at a crucial moment anymore. But, yeah, then the last I heard of her, though, I started to have questions about her when she was playing at the Ocean Mist with her band, and I went to see the show. And, you know, I noticed she was wearing shorts and sneakers, and she had this big burn on her leg. And she said she burned her leg on the tailpipe of a Harley Davidson. Now, that's cool. What wasn't so cool was the fact that I said, well, Lisa, I said, you know the way to, you know the way to heal that up really quick. We'll just go swimming. You know, this was summer. I said, well, just jump in the, we'll just go in the ocean. Yeah, you know, that salt water will heal it right up. She said, no, it'll hurt too much. It's a big cut. Yeah. I don't know. I think that's when I started having a lot more attraction and respect for the women among us that slice themselves up and lay down on barbed wire. And, you know, Lisa, she kind of blew it that night.
Or at least the woman that slices her finger and finishes cooking supper.
At least. I'll tell you, yes. So, yeah, or slices her finger, you know, opening the condom for you with a plastic cut and then finishes. That's the kind of woman we all have to respect. Yes. A woman that, spends all day, with the runs taking a dump and, then cleans herself up and still lets you stick it in there, regardless of the discomfort. As a matter of fact, that's how my second-to-last ex, Melissa, she got kicked out of the running. She just, she just said that was too much discomfort. She said, every time you're up there, it feels like I have diarrhea. I said, well, is that
Taco Bell?
Yeah, I mean, how many fast foods make you feel the same way? I mean, if you're going to let a little thing like that stand between you and sexual satisfaction, or better yet, my sexual satisfaction, no, we're just not compatible. We're really not. So then it's naturally, a couple of weeks later, she says, I want to take this to the next level. I said, no, I don't. That was the end of that.
And she was never seen from again.
Oh, yeah, actually she was, because she also enjoys phone sex. So... yeah, so we were compatible that way for a while. But, now you see the warning signs, though, right? Last I spoke to her, she was hooked up in a nice, monogamous, polite relationship. And, well, actually, I don't know, I might have a little sneaking fondness for her. She tried to run her boyfriend over with a truck. She did, actually. She called me up about a month ago. Says, I need somebody to talk to. What? Well, my fiance is in the hospital. What happened? Well, then she told me the sad story of how he was working on the truck and he asked her to help, which was his first mistake. If you know this girl, I mean, she's got her good points, but you never ask her to help anything mechanical or complicated. So apparently... Their truck, it was a pickup truck. The pickup truck is a manual, okay? He's under the hood. Yeah, the truck's parked in front of their store, their business. He's under the hood, and he asked her to get in the driver's seat and start the truck so he can see if he's got the thing fixed, whatever it was he was fixing. She didn't know. She wasn't familiar with manuals. She didn't know that you're supposed to have your foot either on the brake or the clutch. When you start that truck, or that truck is going to go forward. So she just turned the key. The hood of the trunk closed on her boyfriend. The truck rampaged forward, crashed her boyfriend through the front of his store. And I thought this only happened in soap operas, but he got amnesia from the impact.
Sounds like something out of an Ernest movie.
Yeah, this is documented. This happened. We have the hospital records. We have the traumatized Melissa. We have the lawsuits. We have the man's family trying to kill her because they think she did it deliberately. Yeah. Then he ended up in prison. I'm not quite sure of the connection there, but I think he kind of forgot who she was. She tried to remind him who she was a little too strongly. She convinced him that he was in love with her. the landlord of the building tried to evict them because they didn't like the idea of the truck being run through their property. There was a disagreement between my ex-girlfriend and the landlord, and the guy who had forgotten who she was but was loyal nevertheless because she told him he was supposed to be, grabbed the metal pipe, charged the landlord with the pipe,
wow.
Tried to get through three cops on the way who, see, that was it was a matter of bad timing. You know, my ex had called the three cops because the landlord was hassling her, but they got there just in time to stop her boyfriend from charging to her defense with the steel pipe. So naturally, they locked him up for assaulting a police officer. The building that she ran the truck through still has a hole in it. It's an antique shop and stuffed animals store. So a bunch of teddy bears were destroyed. As far as I know, they're still.
That's the saddest part. All those dead teddy bears.
All those dead teddy bears. And she said, yeah, it had to happen that the truck. There's two big windows in the store. One displays antiques. One displays teddy bears. Naturally, she rammed it right through the teddy bears. Yeah, I mean, how gruesome can it get? So she was the one that, you know, feels like the runs.
I mean, how do people get themselves in situations? I mean, that's like a real life soap opera. How do people get themselves mixed up in crap like that?
Well, I think it starts off with one little element. And then you react wrongly to one little element.
Yeah.
And it kind of snowballs, as they say, or it escalates. In other words, one act of stupidity leads to others, basically. You know, I mean, the act of stupidity on this guy's part was getting engaged to my ex-girlfriend. That was one element of stupidity. The other element of stupidity was asking her to sit behind for any reason. I could have told him that. I mean, couple of years before we broke up, I took her to the beach, and I had just bought this $1,400 camera, which I thought I was going to take some lovely pictures with. And because I didn't want it jouncing around, I put the beach blanket in the back seat and wrapped the camera in the beach blanket. We get to the beach. What's the first thing this nitwit does? She doesn't go to the back to get the cooler out. She doesn't, you know, lock her side of the car. She doesn't get the drinks out of the, no. She runs around to my side, opens the back door where my beach blanket is, whips the beach blanket out of the car like one of those Annette Funicello movies from way back when.
One of the old gimmick where they rip the tablecloth off the dining room table and all the stuff stays.
Right, except my camera didn't stay. She launched it through the air of Scarborough Beach, and it came to crash down in the parking lot. I don't know how that camera survived.
Lucky a seagull didn't grab it.
And when it was in flight, absolutely. Yeah, the last picture it took, the poor thing would have been a seagull's open beak.
I've seen what they can do to clam cakes.
I saw one of those things. Oh, yeah, the old Rocky Point clam cakes, too. Seagulls are relentless. I saw a seagull down at the beach capture this crab. You know, it dived into the water like a kamikaze, comes out of the water carrying this crab. The crab looked like almost as big as the seagull. Right? The thing snapping its claws, putting up a fight. Those seagulls are relentless. Seagull flies around in a circle, right? Flies over the beach, finds a rock, and from about 20 feet up drops the crab on the rock.
Yep.
Yeah. That's the end of the crab. I'll tell you, crabs lead a rough life. They really, a shellfish. I mean, anything where the shell in the water leads a rough life. I mean, they can't get away. You're not. If a seagull attacks, you are not getting away. It's like Rodan dropping down on all those Japanese people. They're not going anywhere. They're just not. How far are we in after this?
If you can believe it, we have 10 minutes left.
Actually, since I got on that sidetrack talking about my ex, Melissa, I do believe it. Because she's the one that caused me to start doing that. Whenever you wanted to have a conversation with her, she would make the conversation so convoluted that you started to do the same thing, trying to get a word in edgewise. So, yeah, so I blame her. So I don't make these segues up. This one is for my ex, Melissa, who the only ex-girlfriend for whom I still bear a little bit of affection in my heart because she's so effed up. And note it, I avoided the
episode. That's good. It's been a rough night around here.
All right. Okay, but this one's for Melissa. Looking back on a very unique relationship. This is Kiss Strange Ways here on the Haunted Cabaret on Rhode Island Free Radio. All right, that was Kiss off what is generally recognized as the best of the Kiss albums by true old-school rock fans, even the new-school rock fans. Their second album, back in the mid-70s, the most notable song from that is the song Going Blind, which has been covered I don't know how many times by grunge bands and alternate bands, and I know Dinosaur Jr. did it. I know the Melvins covered it, and the Melvins. There's a killer version of it. I got to put that on the air one of these weeks. That's awesome. But we're just talking about, you know, during the music, we were just talking about my ex Melissa a little bit more, and you know, because once you start talking about an ex, like memories come flooding back, like bile
it's
up your
stuff
throat
that you blocked out. You all of a sudden remember.
Yeah, it's kind of like acid reflux.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You get a little twinge in your stomach, and then it comes blurting right up your throat. Well, yeah, Melissa. Now, Tony, when was the heyday? You said the heyday of the waterbeds. When was the heyday of
waterbeds? I think it was like late 80s, early 90s.
Okay. Well, she was far too young to have, you know, had a waterbed from back in the day, so I guess she bought it somewhere, found it somewhere, probably from one of the old, you know, middle-aged guys that she screwed. But she probably killed him, and you know, by a heart attack, and inherited his bed, probably. But yeah. So the thing about Melissa was her bedroom was one of her strange ways. The bedroom always had to be in the pitch darkness. She couldn't sleep in anything but pitch darkness. If you had, say, you know, the curtains drawn, and there was a crack of moonlight or a crack of outside light coming through this, she couldn't sleep. So I said, what are you, you know what I'm saying, like, you know, related to cadavers, you know, are you, you know, a vampire, you know, like, what is it? But yeah, she had this big four-poster waterbed in the middle of the room, and she demanded that the lights be blacked out like a World War II blackout all the time, which is fine. You know, I'm perfectly able to feel my way, except when you wake up in a strange room in the middle of the night around 3 in the morning, you got to take a leak. I mean, I suffered more injuries either with my knees on the four posters of the bed, trying to find the door. And naturally, you know, you're trying to find the door, and sometimes you open it. Sometimes you close it on your own hand. Yeah. So, yeah, just one more reason why an ex should remain an ex. And by the way, only once in my life did I break up with a girl and go back to her. Just once. Her name was Judy. She had D-cup boobs. And these boobs, I have never seen anything like it in my life, because she would lay on her back and they'd still stick up straight.
Wow.
Who would think, you know, I wish I had video. Like, you know, seeing would be believing. We broke up because she was obnoxious and I was obnoxious. And, you know, about 2 weeks later, I caved in. It's like you see her walking around with those things. It's like, come on, who would not?
Yeah.
Who would not? But the point being, it took me 3 days to remember very clearly why we broke up. So once did it. From then on, you know, you break up, you stay broken up. Actually, we're about to be broken off from our audience, right? We're about done.
Yeah, it's just about that time.
Do we have time for one more track?
Oh, yeah.
What do we got? We got. All right, do we have time for the Goat Whore?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, good. Yeah, we'll do the Goat Whore because in honor of their appearance at the Metal Blade Records 35th anniversary tour coming up in February. All right, we're out of here, but we'll leave you with Death to the Architects of Heaven off the Blood for the Master CD, one of Goat Whore's best, here on the Haunted Cabaret on Rhode Island Free Radio. Nighty night. We'll be right back.
The beating heart of ever falls burning from the skies.